Since last speaker, previous speaker before me spoke about Greece and the last words were, I just maybe shall continue saying and reminding you that the first bailout was given by the European Union not to Greece, but just to my country, Latvia, as well as to Hungary and Romania in 2009. And just to help these three countries balance the books. Since we are small countries and we were not in Eurozone, there was not much attention to this situation, but the austerity measures started just there and more drastically in Latvia. Very strict conditions were imposed to reform public finances, and this led to massive cuts in public spending and significant cuts in income for public sector employees and others, bringing about deep economic hardship. We may be not have thought so at the time, but I think that European Union's treatment of Latvia, Hungary and Romania in 2009 was in many ways a taste of things to come. We did our best. Our small country, Latvia, has presented ourselves. I have supported the coming of 50 trade unionists of the group, and we were standing in October 2009 before the European Commission building. That time there was not works just to prevent such standings. Now it is so. And we holded banners with slogans, Euro Commission, you are killing Latvia, and save people, not banks. I guess it was first time this slogan was used. Now it is repeated all over Europe, save people, not banks. We also managed to have a company of left-wing politicians, and we initiated debate with that time Commissioner for Finances, Joaquim Almunia, on social conditioning when giving financial support. Some improvements were made in Latvia, but still our people are not happy to protest in the streets. They protested by food. They left Latvia, and in 20 years, we lost 1 million of inhabitants out of 3 million. One-third of population, and many of them are working now in Ireland, Britain, and elsewhere in the European Union, as well as in Russia. So that was the situation. But if you see the title of my speech, it is not on economy and on economic crisis. I have entitled my speech, The Baltic States as a Convenient Irritant for Russia. Why this? First of all, just by the reason of bad social and economic situation. So people are prepared to be not satisfied with situation. Another reason is the attempt to put all historic grievances Baltic states had to local Russian population, which is quite big. In Latvia it is up to 40%, in Estonia up to 20%, and in Lithuania equal minorities, Polish speaking and Russian speaking, in total they are making some 15-18% of population as well. This possibility to... But Baltic states, in difference with situation in other former Soviet republics, have used, when receiving independence, have used very special formula, and just formula of legal continuation of pre-war state, which was a very convenient pretext to punish legally Russian speakers by depriving them of citizenship. The citizens of Latvia as well as Estonia were only those who were citizens before the Second World War and their descendants. All others were claimed as newcomers and received a status of stateless person. Despite this situation, both Latvia and Estonia, having on board about 500,000 of stateless population deprived of all rights, all political rights and a number of social and economic rights, were acknowledged to become members of the European Union, despite the fact that, of course, we did not fulfill Copenhagen criteria. But the decision was geopolitical one, just competing with Russia on the influence on that territories of Baltic states. So that is one example of double standards. Can you imagine what would happen if Russia or Belarus would deprive one third of its population of voting rights? It would be an enormous scandal. Baltic states are told to be democratic societies. You see, and of course, the same situation as Ukraine on depriving of Russian language official status. It has no any status in Baltic states, despite this huge number of native speakers, of Russian native speakers. So using this unsatisfaction of Russian-speaking population, Western media are now invoking the provocative ideas that local Russians in eastern part of Latvia, as well as in Estonia, north eastern part of Estonia, could claim for declaration for independent republics like Latgalian Republic, like Donetsk or Lugansk Republic. And this is just a provocation. After the beginning of these events in Ukraine, we have enormous flow of Western journalists who are just posing us these questions. So who are us? I want to, first of all, maybe just now to present myself. I am only one native Russian speaker out of 751 members of the European Parliament. We are only eight members elected in Latvia, and as I say, half of my potential voters are deprived of the right to vote. That is the situation. We managed to elect also one Estonian representative to actual parliament, but since 2004 I was re-elected three times, two times, and elected first in 2004. We managed to have one more voice of Russian speakers of Baltic states. I am a member of a group where we have regionalists, so-called regionalists and minorities, starting with Skorstic National Party, with RLR from Basque Country, and with my party, Latvian Russian Union. And we, of course, have a lot of pressure on us. And if we return to just to this provocations, the recent one was published article in the New York Times. Author Andrew Higgins It is an issue of May 20. Beforehand, Mr. Higgins visited Brussels. He made an interview with me, as well as then Latvia and the eastern part of Latvia. And his article is entitled "Latvian region has distinct identity and allure for Russia." And this region in question is Latgalia, as I told. And the author is citing the Russian-speaking mayor of Rezekne, capital of Latgalia, who denounces, I'm citing, European sanctions against Russia, trusts Russian television more than Latvia's mostly pro-European news outlets, and worries that NATO will bring trouble, not security. That's the end of citation. So Mr. Higgins is aware of the fact that this region also booked the national trend in a 2012 referendum on whether to make Russian an official state language or not. What European Union and the United States, if want some peaceful resolution of unsatisfaction of Russian-speaking population do? They would recommend just to follow the claims of people in this referendum, and people in Latgalia, in overwhelming majority, ask for official status for Russian language, and it would be in full conformity of European conventions on minorities. No, just in the end of the article, Mr. Higgins is glorifying military activities of Latvian soldiers together with NATO soldiers and saying that just these activities had sent a firm message to Moscow that the risks would be tremendous if it tried to copy its Ukrainian playbook in the Baltics. You see, Baltics, our leading politicians are the biggest hawkist just against Russia, together with Polish politicians. I have in my hands also a recent copy of New York Times, European edition, just in plain I received it. It is from Thursday. And here it is clearly written that some European nations, notably the Baltic states and Poland, pushed for tougher sanctions against Russia, but settled for a simple extension of existing restrictions. So in what concerns this extension of existing restrictions, it will be decided, as it was already mentioned, tomorrow, on Monday, and they are also writing that Athens appears to have decided against picking another fight with the European Union over Russia, since there were doubts whether Greece will support prolongation of sanctions or not. So you see, the situation is very hard, and it is also filled very well in the European Parliament, where last week in the session in Strasbourg, already two resolutions passed, anti-Russian resolutions. And one was prepared by the grandson of former president of Lithuania, Landsbergis, who became, instead of his great father, who was MEP for two terms, now newly elected MEP. And the second, he is in the EPP group. And the second was even stronger, even more acute, was prepared by socialists from Romania, former defense minister Pașcu. Just he was the one who accepted CIA prisons in Romania, which was recently disclosed. Just he was in the time period from 2000 to 2004. And if we speak now about solidarity and some political network which could oppose this anti-Russian, this pro-NATO, this pro-military, these aggressive trends and resolutions and texts approved by the European Parliament, unfortunately, I have to say that there are problems. also against this Landsbergis resolution, there were 135 votes against with 69 abstentions, with 494 in favor. For PASCO resolution, there was almost 50-50, but with a small overwhelming of those in favor, it was 77. So 279 against and abstention. And in this case, my group, Green Group, we are a part of Green Group, European Free Alliance, but in association with Greens, which is very pro-Maidan, anti-Russian oriented, voted the whole group against this PASCO resolution, which was devoted to the military situation in the Black Sea Basin after annexation, so-called annexation, but it was in the title of Crimea by Russia. And the idea was not only to have NATO overwhelming in Baltic countries, to provide Ukraine with arms, to provide Ukraine with another military equipment. The idea for Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine, they would be ready to go to NATO, but PASCO and others who voted in favor proposes them to create new military union and NATO to help this military union of three states to be developed. So very, very dangerous proposals supported, unfortunately, by the majority. And among those, for example, are half of socialist group, with Green Group, GUE Group, and the right-wingers against socialist group, was splitted half to half, but some delegations, for example, Spanish delegations, were in favor. And that is very interesting, and that proves the fact that left-wing politicians, unfortunately, they are their reasons for decision making are mostly interior rather than just political using geopolitical arguments for that. And that is, I will. And also, I have to criticize a little bit also GUE group, left group of the European Parliament, since we have this this situation tackled already by Giulietta Chiesa and others, that we have opposition to this mainstream in both radical sides of political spectrum and of Parliament, European Parliament. That is GUE, and that is right-wing groups. Now Marine Le Pen has managed to organize her political group. She has seven country, one British MEP from UKIP also joined this group. Yes, and some members inside, me including. But in total, as I say, we have about permanently 150 MEPs voting against sanctions, voting against pressure on Russia. But when I proposed GUE group to sign a letter, and I told I will propose it to all those who voted against resolution, they told, we will not sign if there will be Marine Le Pen and others. Yeah? We will only sign in the case we are left wing. So that is just three lines, a letter proposed to write to Council, which will come next Wednesday, and Foreign Affairs Ministers coming Monday, against prolongation of sanctions. We voted together, but they don't want to sign together. That is a position which does not give us possibility to have a union. Giulietta Chiesa told us about just a union against war, against NATO, against sanctions, in favor of new political platform, and just this idea was included in the Sofia Declaration here about, among members of this conference. We are five signatories of this declaration, and I have distributed the text, and I would like to, we would like all us, five of us, among them Dimitris Constantakopoulos, to ask those who wishes to join our Sofia Club and to sign Sofia Declaration. Thank you.